All right, I want to begin and give you some general comments on the parables, and then that'll take a little bit of time, and then I want to begin introducing the kingdom of God, which I talked about before, but I need to repeat, and then we'll just see how far we get. Now, the English word parable, we're going to be looking at parables, but we say, what is that about? The English word parable is taken from the Greek word parabole. But that Greek word parabole and its parallel in Hebrew and Aramaic, it has a much broader meaning than our English word parable. When you look in the Gospels of how parable is used, parabole, the Greek word, how that word is used in the Gospels, it includes things that we would classify as proverbs, maxims, riddles, and even comparisons and contrasts. So when you're talking about we're going to study the parables, well, what exactly are you talking about studying? And the teachings of Jesus that we'll be focusing on can best be defined this way. Now, I undoubtedly took this from somebody, but I didn't note where, so I don't remember where I got this. But I liked it, so that's why you're seeing it. So it's a word picture of a familiar but fictional or imaginary circumstance. So you have a word picture of a familiar, something everybody relates to, but it's fictional or imaginary circumstance that's given to communicate indirectly by analogy, and that's really the power of parables, about the hearer's circumstance so as to motivate the hearer to act on his or her new insight. You see, and that's really what's being done. It's this word picture of something here that's this circumstance, fictional or imaginary, that's this indirect analogy that then allows me, it hits me, and then it's to motivate me to act and to change and be different. So it's a very powerful teaching tool. Now that's more detailed, that definition, but I think it's more adequate than the popular definition of earthly stories with heavenly meanings. Now inherent in that definition, inherent there is the notion that the purpose of parables is to communicate effectively, and that Jesus intended to communicate by parables. It's obvious from the fact that he said them rather than remaining silent. I mean, if he didn't want to communicate, he'd just keep his mouth shut. So the fact he said the parables indicates that he's intending by them to communicate, and that's confirmed by his urging people to hear what he was saying through the parable. And you can see that in Matthew 13:9. 21:33, and his questions to the disciples in Mark chapter 4, verse 13, make clear that it was his intention that they understood the parables. I'm saying this because it's his intention to communicate. That's why he's telling parables. He's intending to communicate effectively. Matthew 13, 34 and 35, Jesus indicates that his speaking in parables had a revelatory function. He's trying to make something known in speaking in parables. But that raises a question. You see, when you say, well, no, parables are intended to communicate effectively, well, it then raises this question as to how that communicative purpose squares with Mark chapter 4, verses 10 through 12, and the parallels to that in Matthew 13 and Luke 8. Those texts, especially the text in Mark chapter 4, verses 10 through 12, they could be read to teach that Jesus told parables to obscure the truth so as to prevent people from coming to understanding and salvation. You could read that way, that what he's really doing is trying to hide and obscure the truth to keep people from coming to an understanding and salvation. But I think that's a misunderstanding of those texts. I think what's going on is in what they teach is that Jesus speaks the truth about the kingdom in the disarming and defense-piercing form of parables so that the hardness of outsiders, this hardness that is mentioned in Isaiah, so that the hardness of outsiders in failing to perceive and understand the truth, see, without which hardness they could turn and be healed. But he tells these things so that Isaianic hardness in failing to perceive and understand the truth so that it will be manifested clearly. It will be exposed. It will be laid bare. That is what is existing out there. It is a hardness that refuses to hear under the best possible circumstances. That refuses to hear when the truth is packaged even in a defense-piercing way. See, that's what I think he's talking about and what's going on. See, by giving the unbelievers through parables the maximum opportunity to engage and thus ultimately to receive the truth, by presenting it indirectly in pictorial language, he puts their hardness in the boldest relief possible. He lays it bare. You see, he lays the hardness bare by giving them this maximum opportunity to be grabbed by it. He comes in indirectly by analogy with these picture stories. And if they're rejecting that, if their hardness is so great they reject that, well, then it's exposed for what it is. He's not trying to keep people from understanding and from hearing. So he speaks to them in parables because they are hard-hearted. He's giving them the maximum opportunity to engage, and so that, as he says here in Mark 4:12, so that they will manifest the hardness as a testimony against themselves. All right, I wanted to, because sometimes when you talk about parables, you say, well, no, really, what's going on? He's trying to obscure. I don't think that's what's happening. I think there is obscuring, but it's because the hardness of heart makes them refuse to accept even when he's teaching them in parables. You see, and that's what I think is happening. Now, why is that said in these Gospels, in Mark 4 and those other texts I mentioned? I think the report of that stated purpose, I think it functions in the Gospels as an encouragement to the readers of the Gospels to receive the message. See, to reject the message is to show oneself among the hard-hearted. So I think that's why it's reported there. All right. Now, that parables are intended to communicate effectively, that doesn't mean that all parables are immediately or easily comprehended. They are not. Okay, it doesn't mean that they're readily or easily comprehended, immediately or easily comprehended. The disciples found some of Jesus' parables puzzling. And they ask him for an explanation. You see that in Matthew 13:36 and Mark 7:17 and Luke 8:9. See, the effectiveness of a parable, it sometimes depends on the meaning of the parable not being apparent on the surface. You see, its effectiveness is sometimes dependent on its meaning not being obvious. That's part of how it draws a person in. That's part of how it gets past the person's defenses, you see. I have to package it in a way so that's not immediately obvious, so you drink it in, and then later it goes boom. You see, so that's part of it. So they're not all immediately obvious. Certainly not obvious on the surface. That's how it, you know, it's part of drawing them in, getting past their offenses. Parables communicate effectively in their ability to bring the message home. That's the effectiveness of communication of parables, to drive the message home. See, not in their ability to communicate information directly or obviously. That's not what we're talking about. Now, Klein Snodgrass, it's an interesting name, but he's a very well-known scholar. He's a professor of New Testament studies at North Park Theological Seminary in Chicago, and he spent most of his academic career focusing on Jesus' teachings, and particularly on the parables. And in 2008, he published his magnum opus, which is a 800-plus page tome titled Stories with Intent, A Comprehensive Guide to the Parables of Jesus. He says in that book, and I'll be referring to Snodgrass, he's written a lot of things on parables and various dictionaries and this kind of thing. But Snodgrass says, parables are not always obvious and self-explanatory, but even when enigmatic, see, even when you're scratching your head and going, what's going on here? Their purpose is to enlighten. The very uncertainty of their reference is part of their appeal and often the means of their effectiveness, but they're not meant to obfuscate. So that's what I want you to know. Something I want you to recognize is they're not meant to obfuscate as sometimes we seem to think. Now, Robert Stein, another New Testament scholar, he's currently teaches a professor of New Testament interpretation at Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. He says in his chapter called The Genre of Parables, and this is in a book titled The Challenge of Jesus' Parables, but Robert Stein says, through a parable, Nathan was able to discuss the issue of David's murder of Uriah and his adultery with Uriah's wife, for the reality part of the parable was only recognized after the parable had been told and explained. How far would Nathan have gotten if he'd said to David, "Oh, king, I'd like to talk to you about your adultery with Bathsheba and your murder of Uriah"? Well, that wouldn't have flown. You see, well, he's going to talk to him about it, and he's going to talk to him about it powerfully, but do you see how he goes about it? If he had said that, I suspect David wouldn't have had any of it. Stein continues, the nature of a parable, however, enabled the prophet to speak to David about both his adultery and his murder, for disarmed by the innocuous nature of the parable, David was open to judge honestly the issue at hand. And that's the beauty, you see, of parables. They slip past the defenses. They come in and get you, see, it's by analogy. And so when you come in and you hear that, you can then see clearly the principle and the truth. And then when it applied to you, you go, ooh. You see, ooh, I get it. So that's what's taking place now. Teaching through parables was not unique to Jesus. Snodgrass states in his article titled Parables in the Dictionary of Jesus and the Gospels, Snodgrass says, Jesus was not the first person to teach by parables and stories. There are both Greek and Semitic antecedents, but there's no evidence of anyone prior to Jesus using parables as consistently, creatively, and effectively as he did. He is the master. You see, he's the master. Yes, parables were used. People have been using parables a long time. But when Jesus takes up parables, you know, he's sailing. I mean, he's really, the master is at work. Now, the vagueness of the term parable, like I said, parabole, this Greek term, is broader than the English word parable. So there's some vagueness about, well, what do you mean by parables? When you're going to study parables, what are you going to look at? Well, because the term is vague, that's led to some disagreement over how many parables are there. Snodgrass says that the estimates range from 37 in the Gospels, from 37 to 65. See, it just depends on what this qualifies, doesn't qualify. So you have this range of what is a parable, from 37 to 65. Now, I don't plan to discuss everything that could be classified as a parable, but I'm going to discuss enough of them in the class that I suspect you'll be happy to have me stop. Okay, so we'll talk about quite a few of them. Now, like David Wenham was a professor of New Testament at the University of Oxford for 24 years. He has a book, The Parables of Jesus. David, like Wenham, I've included in what we'll be talking about, I've included some things that some people would not consider parables, and I've excluded some things that somebody else would say, hey, that's a parable, you should talk about that too. Okay, I'm aware of that, but that's just how it had to be. I had to make some decisions and choices. Now, there are also different ways of classifying parables. You have people who go and they say, look, we've got like Snodgrass in his book, Stories with Intent. He has 7 classifications of parables, and I won't bore you with the titles of those classifications. Arlind Hultgren, in his commentary on the parables, Hultgren is a professor of New Testament at Luther Seminary in Minnesota. Hultgren just has 2 classifications. So you've got Snodgrass, you've got 7. Hultgren has just 2. His are narrative parables and similitudes, and I'm not going to spend any time on that. Okay? How you classify them, where they are, is not really my concern. My concern is what's Jesus trying to say? However they're classified. Okay, so I'm not gonna pick up that debate and that discussion. Now, as for the arrangement, how am I grouping these things and arranging them? The order that I'm going to present them in. Well, in that regard, I sympathize with David Wenham, who said it's hard to know where to begin or how to arrange a study of Jesus' parables. Almost any arrangement has its advantages and disadvantages. Now, the scheme that I use, the arrangement that I'm going to use, has been influenced by and inspired by David Wenham's book on the parables of Jesus and Snodgrass's book, Stories with Intent, but I've modified it as I thought best. But you can definitely see their footprint in what I'm doing and see it quite clearly. Now, the task of interpreting parables, that task is made more difficult by our distance from the culture, the language, and the historical context in which the parables were spoken. We have to dig our way back to first century Palestine to have any hope of hearing the parables correctly. We got to do our best to dig our way back. In addition, we have to develop an educated feel. See, there, this is kind of an art form. We have to develop an educated feel of what aspects of the parable are significant to the point or the points being made, and what aspects are simply part of the story structure. See, that's critical. You see, is everything, does it have some meaning? Or are there things that are simply part of the story structure and the packaging of the message? Okay, well, you see, there's room for people to say, well, no, he says this. I know he says that. But I think that's part of the story structure. You see, this is what I think is important. So I'm going to give you my judgment on that. You may be sitting there going, well, you know, the guy missed that. Okay. I mean, you know, I understand. I'm a fallen human being, so don't be shocked. But I just want to say, I'm going to use my best educated feel on what is significant in the parables, give that to you. You weigh that and you see, you know, well, I think he's got a good point. I think he's off base. All right. But you know how I do this. You've been in the classes. At least I assume most of you have been here before. Otherwise, you would have fled when you saw I was teaching. You'd be, is there anything else I got to get out? No. Okay. So yeah, now, let me quote Snodgrass. He says, the key is knowing when to stop interpreting. I think that's very important. The key is knowing when to stop interpreting. But could somebody say, well, you shouldn't have stopped there? Yes, they could. You see, they could say that. But you have to say, okay, this is this sense of feel. He continues, he says, as with metaphor, parable interpretation is about understanding the limits and the significance of the analogy. You see, he's communicating indirectly by analogy. So that's the thing, is what is he getting at with the analogy? Snodgrass says elsewhere, parables do not give complete pictures. Okay, so you can't just take one parable and build, you know, that this is all of New Testament theology. That's not why parables are told. Okay, he says, parables do not give complete pictures, and certainly not complete pictures of theology. We should know by now that parables do not all work the same, and that each parable must be dealt with individually. Some have multiple correspondences, and some do not. Some use stock metaphors. But metaphors are always capable of being used in novel ways. Determining where an image has a direct correlation and where images do not is key to correct interpretation. That's just saying in different ways this idea about this feel for what really is relevant to the point or points being made and what is simply part of the structure of the story and part of the package. Now, as you know, the kingdom of God was central to Jesus' ministry and message. Absolutely central to his ministry and message. Matthew 4:23 says, Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness among the people. And Jesus says in Luke chapter 4, verse 43, I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God to the other towns also, because that's why I was sent. I was sent to what? To preach the good news of the kingdom. You see, this is something that is central. You can see this in other texts that I'll mention later. George Ladd, in his very influential book, A Theology of the New Testament, George Ladd says, modern scholarship is quite unanimous. Now, when somebody like this says something like that, it's a bold statement. Okay? When you're saying that scholarship's quite unanimous about, would that be literally? Nothing's literally unanimous, okay? You can find people to think anything. But the fact somebody of this caliber would make this statement shows you how large the consensus is. Modern scholarship is quite unanimous in the opinion that the kingdom of God was the central message of Jesus. G.R. Beasley Murray, a Baptist scholar, he's now dead, but in his book, Jesus and the Kingdom of God, Murray says, the kingdom of God pervades the entire proclamation of Jesus recorded in the Gospels and appears largely to have determined the course of his ministry. Everett Ferguson, who was a longtime professor of church history at Abilene Christian University, one of our true scholars, he says this in his book, The Church of Christ, the Biblical Ecclesiology for Today. All three synoptic gospels characterize the central theme of Jesus' preaching as the kingdom of God. Arlen Hultgren, the professor of New Testament from Luther Seminary, who wrote a commentary on the parables, Arlen Hultgren says, the kingdom was certainly a main theme, even the main theme of Jesus' message. Virtually all scholars would agree on that point. So that's an important, see, that I want you to see this kingdom of God is central to Jesus' preaching. This is why I've come. I'm preaching about this kingdom of God. And Jesus' parables, they focus on various aspects of the kingdom. That's what his parables are about. Snodgrass says the primary focus of the parables is the coming of the kingdom of God and the resulting discipleship that is required. Stephen Sheely, he says in his article, Kingdom of God, in Erdman's Dictionary of the Bible, he says, even the parables of Jesus, which do not seem to have a surface connection to the kingdom, address the need for proper behavior and relationships in the light of the coming of God's kingdom. And more forcefully, David Wenham, who is the Oxford New Testament guy, David Wenham says in his book, The Parables of Jesus, what are Jesus' parables all about? The simple answer to that question is that they are all describing some aspect of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God was the central theme of Jesus' preaching and indeed of his whole ministry, and the parables should all be seen and understood in that context. So it is going to be helpful, indeed it is necessary, to have an understanding of the kingdom of God as a background to studying the parables of Jesus. And that's the task for the remainder of the introduction. Okay, I'm looking up here. I've got like maybe 18 minutes left. That's not going to happen. So I'm going to do as far as I can. I'll come back in 3 weeks and try to reorient you, and then we'll pick back up. But it's important to do that. Now, I know that I taught on the kingdom of God at the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. It's because it's central to New Testament theology. It's very important in the Sermon on the Mount. But I have to repeat it because some of you weren't here for that. And also, anybody who would be watching the class online, which Bernard, he posts them online. So if anybody were to watch the class, they have to have access to this introduction material for them to appreciate how I'm understanding the parables. So I'm going to need to do that. Now, if you were here for the Sermon on the Mount, and maybe other times you've heard me talk about the kingdom of God because it's a powerful subject, something I like to talk about, but if you were here for that, just bear with me. I'm hoping that the repetition will solidify the point, and also it will reinforce for you the significance of the topic. So, you know, a lot of times you have to hear things. You know, you have to hear things and maybe think, well, I don't know about that. I don't know about this. Okay. But just to have it repeated so maybe it won't be a total loss on you even if you were here. Now, God in the beginning, we're starting. See, the Bible is a coherent book. You see, it's not just chopped up. There is a story of the Bible. And God in the beginning, he miraculously created all things, including human beings, Adam and Eve, during the 6 days of creation. And the creation was at first, it was an ideal place. Absolutely ideal place in which all things were acting in a way God desired. Everything was functioning harmoniously. All things working according to God's will, and that's why he says it's very good. So that's how things were initially. It was at first that ideal place, but soon Adam and Eve, who were to be God's representatives on earth, they rejected his rule by disobeying him, and by bringing sin into the human world, they spoiled God's very good creation. They tarnished God's very good creation. And as a result, creation is not now the way it's supposed to be. In fact, that's the title of a book about sin. Creation is not now the way it's supposed to be. See, it's no longer a paradise where all things function and operate together in peace and harmony under God's rule. This perfect existence where all things are operating that way. Instead, our world now includes things like anger and division and violence and destruction and death and decay and lying and stealing and suffering and sorrow and pain. That is the world we live in. It is a world that is sick from sin. It is a sick world, a creation that's sick as a result of sin. It's fallen. The creation has fallen from its original state of glory, which is why Adam's sin is known in Christian theology as the fall. There was this beginning, there was this introduction of corruption and wrong and a spoiling of this great perfect creation, and now it's here. It's here. It's corrupted and spoiled. And the story of the Bible is the story of God's work through the people of Israel to rescue His creation, which includes mankind, to rescue it from its fallen state. People are the high point of God's creation. But His rescue effort, it includes all of creation. Because all of creation was harmed as a result of sin. That's why Paul says in that very significant text in Romans chapter 8, verses 19 to 22, he says that creation itself looks forward to the day it will be freed from the consequences of human sin. It is there waiting, you see. It's waiting for this renewal, this freeing. It was enslaved or subjective in bondage to decay. And it's waiting to be liberated from that, which will happen in conjunction with the liberation of God's people. You see, now the scope and breadth of Christ's healing, that it is broader than simply people. You can see that, for example, in Colossians chapter 1, 19 and 20, where Paul speaks of Jesus as the one through whom God the Father reconciled all things to Himself. He reconciled all things to Himself, making peace by the blood of His cross. You can see it also in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10, where Paul says, "The mystery of God's will for the administration of the fullness of the times, for the outworking of the fullness of the times, is to bring all things together in Christ, the things in the heavens and the things on earth." All things, you see. It is this rescue of the spoiled creation. All things will be healed. Christ is that significant. Christ is the center of this, for all the promises of God find their yes in Him. 2 Corinthians 1:20. Now the Old Testament, in this story, we have this pristine, very good creation. Sin is introduced. There is corruption. Creation is spoiled. We see where it's going. That the story is God's rescue of this fallen or sick creation. And the Old Testament, it ends on a note of unfulfilled hope. See, it was clear that in one sense, God had ruled the world from the time of creation. This is a thing I think people struggle with getting. God had ruled the world from the time of creation. He was on His heavenly throne. You see that in Psalm 11:4, Isaiah 6:1. He reigned over all. 1 Chronicles 16:31, Psalm 93:1, Psalm 96:10. That's not the question. He's sovereign. He's on His throne. He's always ruling. See, but there was some sense in which His kingly rule, His sovereign power and might, was not being fully expressed. He was allowing creation to go on out of step with His ultimate intention for it, to continue in a state of sin and suffering that was contrary to his ultimate purpose and vision. He's allowing creation to go on in this spoiled, corrupted state. Is he sovereign? Yes. Is he on his throne? Yes. But there is some sense in which he is not asserting that rule as he will one day when he will eliminate all that is contrary to his eternal purpose and vision. On that day, he will be king, as it says in Zechariah 14:9. See, so yes, he's king. Yes, he's on his throne. But there's a sense in which he's allowing creation to go on in this state. But at some point, he will assert his sovereignty so that all that is corrupt, all that is contrary to this eternal purpose will be stripped out. So he will be king in a different sense, in that he's asserting his inherent sovereignty in a different way than he is now. That's the idea. You see, that's the idea. The prophets, okay, so the Old Testament ends on this note of unfulfilled hope, but the prophets saw that a day was coming when God would express his rulership of creation in such a way that all things would be brought into harmony and conformity with his ultimate will and purpose. His creation would be redeemed from the dreadful consequences of sin that had invaded it. This world of rebellion, this world of sin, this world of hostility, this world of fragmentation, it would be rescued by him and transformed by him into a true utopia, this perfect reality of love and joy and fulfillment and complete fellowship with God and one another. You see, this true divine utopia, that this would come about. Craig Bartholomew and Michael Goheen, they write in their book, The Drama of Scripture, Finding Our Place in the Biblical Story. All right, Bartholomew and Goheen, here's what they say. The people of Israel thought of history being comprised of two very distinct periods. Now, just register that, because that's one of the things Jesus is going to correct. See, they thought two very distinct periods. You go along here, boom, here. But that's not why I'm showing you this slide right now. He says, the people of Israel thought of history being comprised of two very distinct periods, the present age and the age to come. In the present age, which had begun with Adam's rebellion against God's rule, the whole of creation had been stained by sin. Inevitably, therefore, evil would continue to flourish in the world throughout the present age, even among God's own people of Israel, who had come to be called out to provide the solution to that evil. But in the age to come, God would intervene to cleanse and renew his creation. You see, he's rescuing his wonderful creation. He's not sacrificing the creation and telling Satan, let's go best 2 out of 3. You won that one. Okay. No, he's not doing that. He's going to redeem creation. You see? And so this is what they're talking about. Then you see this same idea. You know, on that day that they're speaking about, on that day, see, God would express his authority over creation in a way he's not doing at present. You see, in his sovereign power, is he on the throne? Yes. Is he sovereign? Yes. But on that day, he would express that sovereignty and express that power in a way that he's not doing now. He would, in his sovereign power, bring his creation to its ultimate fulfillment. He would rescue it and redeem it so that all that is contrary to this eternal purpose, to this true divine utopia, would be stripped out. See, that's what's going on here. At that time, as I said, he will be king. You say, well, how can he say will be future? Well, is he king? Yes, he's king. But there's also a sense in which he will be king, as you see in Zechariah. Robert Saucy, in his article, The Eschatology of the Bible, in the Expositor's Bible Commentary, he says, according to the Scriptures, there's a sense in which God has always ruled and is even now the king over all creation. But there's another thread of truth that views the kingdom as yet to come. It is this last theme that dominates the eschatological hope of Scripture. God is king over all his creative works, but his kingdom is not established on the earth in human history in the sense that we're talking about. Okay. While he rules over the affairs of the earth with nothing occurring apart from his permissive will, he has allowed sin and rebellion to enter history and Satan to have a certain dominance as the God of this age. God's rule might be said, therefore, to be over the earth, but not directly on the earth. Whether you want to quarrel with that, it's fine with me. It is the coming of God to establish this latter condition, to bring his kingdom to earth in the vindication of his sovereign holiness that has constituted the hope of God's people throughout all time. You see, and what troubles me, it seems to me that we have allowed that hope and that vision to fade. This was always something that is central to New Testament theology. And we've allowed that, well, you know, that's like, as I said before, you know, this idea of you have this scholar about, you know, demythologizing the New Testament. And I'm afraid we've been influenced by this idea. Look, you know, that all sounds so fantastic. And it's been so long, who cares? This is the Christian hope. You can't be talking about this without pointing to that. You see, and I just think sometimes we lose sight of that. I. Howard Marshall, a very well-known evangelical scholar. I think he's been called the dean of evangelical New Testament scholars. I. Howard Marshall, in his book, Jesus the Savior, he says, the kingdom of God is the full and powerful manifestation of the sovereignty that God already exercises over the world. So this is what I'm getting. He's on his throne, yes. He's sovereign, yes. But he's doing something so that at some point he's going to express that sovereignty in a way where all that's contrary to this eternal purpose and vision is removed. That's how Marshall puts it. N.T. Wright, he's perhaps the best known theologian in the world today. He says, and in a phrase pregnant with meaning for both Jews and Christians, the age to come would above all be the kingdom of God. Okay, so you see that idea that here we have this broken thing going on, present age, boom, age to come. Age to come what? This is when everything's set right. All of the brokenness is healed. Okay, age to come, kingdom of God. Israel's God would become in reality what he was already believed to be. He would be the king of the whole world in that sense of expressing the sovereignty that was his. Craig Keener, another well-known New Testament scholar, he says, like the Old Testament, Jewish teachers could speak of God's rule, especially among the people who obeyed his law, but Jewish people also looked for the kingdom as God's future rule, when he would reign unchallenged, as attested in regular Jew. Reign unchallenged. Well, Satan is what? The God of this age. He's going to reign unchallenged. Okay, he's coming in then and asserting his sovereignty in a way that he's not doing right now. Daryl Bach, who's another well-known New Testament scholar, he writes in the Historical Jesus, Five Views, he says, although the kingdom of God is not a common phrase in Hebrew Scripture, the idea that God rules is a frequent concept within it, within Scripture, and Second Temple Judaism. However, this concept, as Jesus used it, is not about the inherent sovereignty of God as creator, that he's on the throne, that he's sovereign. Yes, yes, yes. You see, rather, it treats the idea of his promised redeeming rule expressed afresh in the world in the arrival of a newly dawning age of shalom, age of peace, age of harmony, age of reconciliation. You see, the kingdom vindicates the righteous and brings ultimate justice. Now, the Old Testament, it uses different imagery. It uses different imagery to refer to what God is going to bring about, to this blessed state that God is going to create in the healing and redeeming of this sin-sick creation. The imagery varies in how sharply the blessed state being portrayed, how sharply it is distinguished from present history. There are varying degrees of how sharply it's... Sometimes it seems radically discontinuous, the picture. Other times it seems like, okay, it's a blessed state, but I could see that's being something that takes place within history. But all of these pictures say, in language relevant to ancient Jews, that a day of great blessing is coming. That God is going to act in a way that he's going to provide great blessings. It says that the failures and the sufferings of the present age will be put to rights by the coming new age. Sometimes the Old Testament speaks of the restoration of Israel to greatness and the coming of a new king, like Israel's great King David. Sometimes it speaks of God's healing of the world's sicknesses and hatreds. Sometimes it speaks of God's people being freed from oppression. Sometimes it speaks of renewed prosperity and justice for the poor. Sometimes it speaks of war and the weapons of war being abolished. Sometimes it speaks of death being swallowed up and tears being wiped away. Sometimes it speaks of the alienation between God and man being removed. And sometimes it speaks of the God's Spirit being poured out. And sometimes it speaks of a new heaven and a new earth. Perhaps the most radically discontinuous picture. But see, as I say, all of it is saying, blessing is coming. Blessing is coming. Overturn, correction, redemption, healing, God breaking in to act and to undo this story that's been going on, to finish it out. And that's what Jews were looking for. In the first century, this is where the parables are. This is why I'm telling you this. We're getting there, you see. In the first century, Israel is weak, poor, and they're under the rule of pagans, the Romans. Graham Goldsworthy, in his book, According to Plan, The Unfolding Revelation of God in the Bible, he says, the return from exile results in only a pale shadow of the predicted glorious kingdom for the people of God. Okay, remember they're exiled. 587, they get taken off the Babylonian captivity. And then they're there, and like 539, we have the defeat of the Babylonians, and they come back a couple years after that. Is that what God's talking about? No, you see, they come back and it's just a pale shadow of all of these promises from these prophets. These prophets are pointing to stuff that says, man, this is like mind-blowing. And they come back and they go, hey. And they come back and go, this doesn't really seem like it. Here's what Thomas Schreiner, another New Testament scholar, says in his book, New Testament Theology. He says, the prophets promised a new creation, a new temple, a new covenant, a new king. The exile would be over and the wilderness would bloom. The great promises in the prophets, however, were not fulfilled when the exile ended in 536 B.C. Is that second bell? Let me finish this quote and then you're through. Okay. He says, Israel did return from Babylon and a temple was built, yet the temple was insignificant in comparison to the Solomonic temple. Nor was the nation enjoying glorious prosperity. The King of Glory envisioned in Isaiah 40-66, Israel was small, struggling, and under the oppression of former powers. Ezra, Nehemiah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi document the low spiritual state of the nation. Nor did matters improve in the 400 years before the coming of Jesus of Nazareth. Israel was a pawn in the struggle between the Ptolemies and the Seleucids. A brief period of freedom dawned with the Hasmoneans in the 2nd to 1st centuries B.C., but the interlude was brief, and soon the Romans swept in and subjugated Israel, appointing the Herodians and procurators to rule the land. You see, it is in that environment where people are longing for, oppressed, wondering what God is doing, that Jesus comes and says, the kingdom of God is at hand. That's what he's talking about. Okay, in 3 weeks, Lord willing, see you back.